floor is just too many everywhere.
Sure, sure.
Can you come to me?
Going along with life, we sort of become a patterned in a way of life, and we don't want to break that pattern. Whenever that pattern is broken, we are devastated. So then that's the time when we experience grief. But children that way, they have that marvelous ability to bounce back because they're so optimistic, and at heart, they're so optimistic. So if we just allow children to be themselves and not put our fears into them or our sense of guilt into them, that aapne aisa kiya, isliye aisa hua, kyun kiya aapne, things like that, you know, then I think they'll be in a better position to master grief. Over to Roopsha.
Wow, that was quite a deep session and a brief session though on grief, but will always be, you know, I will definitely remember it just like all of you. To my left, as we all know, that Subhashis Banerji is getting extremely angry while I'm giving the microphone because he does not need a microphone. I have understood he does not need a microphone, speaker output, he does not need audience, he does not need anything because he is a leader and with him it means success is unlimited. So, Roopsha.
Thank you, ma'am. Hello. Let me define the grief. Grief is not the thing which happens alone. It starts with, the basic is upset. Then it goes to grief disorder or complicated grief disorder. Okay. Grief, what is grief? Grief is any situation, event or occurrence which paralyzes your normal routine, mental, physical, emotional functions. Okay, why do grief happens? Various causes. Okay, it could be death of a loved one, suicide. Let me explain why I am qualified to talk about that. I was with a bunch of highly qualified, highly placed executives. Okay, in a young president forum. So that means all the presidents of different organizations are there, and they asked. They had this question: what is your qualification? I said, my qualification is I failed miserably in many places. Okay. So today's topic, not professional one, I will talk about why, what has happened to me. I have had two losses, my spouse losses. I lost my first wife when my kid was only 6 months old. She got, okay, for 2 years I was totally devastated. At the time, we were supposed to migrate to Canada, and then did this thing, a total U-turn. No more ambitions, nothing. Then suddenly, I came across an organization called Sanjeevani. Sanjeevani is one of the finest domestically abused female counseling organization in Delhi. They were very tough things which people think anybody can counsel. But the worst thing, when you come across those cases, you won't be able to sleep, you won't be able to breathe. You will get paralyzed yourself, so detachment. Right. So I learned, I was there for 2 months. Then I lost my second wife because she happened to get a disorder which is very difficult thing, and just to be hospitalized. It's called narcissistic personality disorder. The person who goes outside, people will think the best personality. That person cannot be better, you cannot have a better person. But the person who are closest to them, go through a trauma, you can't even believe business. My daughter's career. Okay, she was in the finest school of Delhi University, finest college of Delhi University, and I took her out and took to somebody, took to Singapore because of my perception. So I have had more failures, more grief, more trauma, and then I had the training. Okay, I would like this audience to interact because we can keep on lecturing that you can find on internet. But if you can share why you are here, why this subject interests you, you have any personal grief? Because let me tell you one thing. Grief is like a gas.
Could you please tell when you lost your first wife and for 2 years you said you were in grief. So what did you do? I mean, how did you had a 6-month-old son when your wife died. So naturally looking after the son was there. So how did you deal with that?
No, at the time, see, first thing, let me, I later, no, okay, there. Okay, when we reached there, I could speak one word and then she passed away. So, it was shock. Why this happened? Then, anger. How the hell God can do this to me?
Why me?
The anger comes like that. Then I started saying, God, if you give her back, it's bargaining. You give her back to me, I will do anything. Okay. I went through that, but for me it was a long time. Because when you are attached with a person very much, daughter, because at the time I could not do anything. And daughter was having her own traumatic experience. I don't know, I can't explain. Every day of the month, of the same date, she will have peculiar symptoms. Okay, unexplainable symptoms. Then slowly, something came. Okay, are there people who are more traumatized? Okay, let me find out from them. Can I help them? Then that comes. And then slowly the recovery started. Then the acceptance, and then murdered her so much, but she's still living in the same grief. Her grief cycle is not complete. Okay? Different people. And this myth also delays your recovery. Right? Could I answer your question, ma'am? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Since marriage for almost 7 years now, he's in Delhi studying. I had conceived after 4 years of my marriage, and that happened after a lot of treatment. Okay, so obviously, like now, everything was very good because we both are almost well settled, we were doing well professionally. Like, we need to do ultrasounds. After doing the ultrasound after 4.5 months, I was told that the child is abnormal and I cannot keep that child. So, today I'm told that, like, we cannot. Abort after 5 months period. So I was told that it's getting over after 2 days, and so you have to do it immediately after the, otherwise legally you cannot do that. My husband, he was in Delhi then, so it was Wednesday. I still remember, like, I got admitted on Thursday. My husband, he applied for leave. He was not given leave because he's also into medical profession. He's still studying there. He could not come. And I was admitted, I was all alone in the hospital, I stay alone, and my parents, I told them, no, you don't have to come. When he's not there, I don't want anybody else around, because nobody can take his place. And I remember, like, after 3 days, it was not happening, then the doctor say that, no, you have to go for a surgery, because it's not happening, and we cannot keep it delayed for so long. I said, no, I'm losing the child, I cannot allow to myself to get operated. And, you know, I feel it's all in the state of mind. I started doing exercise in that room and like that squatting position and all. I want to come out of this shock and episode. I didn't cry for 3 days because I felt that will make me weak in absence of my family members. And like you said, I didn't cry. So many of my family members, when they came, they said, oh, she's not at all feeling bad. She's so normal, and because like she's so career oriented that losing a child is not affecting her. It's not for that, just because I didn't want to make myself weak, because crying will not bring back the child back. And after that, what happened, like, since I'm into medical profession, there were a lot of patients and all, they started creating a scene in the hospital that why the doctor is not there. We have come all the way from Bangladesh, Nepal and all. It was Friday, and from Monday there was a scene in the hospital. I was given 3 weeks leave, and I got called from the hospital that, ma'am, the patients are creating a scene, that why didn't you inform us? We have come all the way. But this was not something which was planned. I could not inform. I said, forget it, I'm coming. The doctor told it, I have given you 3 weeks leave, and how could you take leave, like, could come. I joined on the very next day, and it was very painful, very traumatic, and I felt that I started working much more than what I was doing earlier, because I wanted to come out of the shock, and that way my practice improved a lot, and I always wanted to have my independent setup after 2 to 3 years. Okay, but because I worked so hard and the practice increased so much, I could see that, like, the entire setup, it happened just after 8 months. That is because I did not allow that episode to affect me.
Was it channel your grief? Channel your grief.
Exactly, because I didn't allow to think. Now also, when I go, they say, oh, tumhare abhi bhi bachcha nahi hua. Come on, there are so many good things that are happening in life. That is not the end of life. I had to think in a positive way. What if I had not known during the ultrasound that the child was abnormal and I had to live all my life suffering? So I took it positively. But what was, like, why me? Then why I had to go through that phase after 4 years of my marriage? Bacha nahi hota, toh bhi toh theek rehta. But maybe after that, like, I felt that maybe God wanted me to experience that phase, and that mentally it has made me much more stronger. And I do no longer cry for the small things. I see people like crying for small things. They make issue, something very small thing, they start creating a scene at home. But that, I feel that is useless. There are so many bigger things in life that we should cry. These are very small compared
to it. Happy and gay because sorrows invade our way. But do not worry, tomorrow is brighter than today. At 35, when I look back, that at 13 I had written that, I could understand, okay, I think I was born an adult. But in me, there is a 14-year-old who will not cry because I've understood one thing in professional life. Specifically, I will speak because here I have come as a professional on radio. I will not talk about my personal life here, but as a professional, I have understood, like most of us who have worked in organizations, we suffer loss on account of a lot of things, politics, rivalry, everything. But the best thing is in life to give it back with your success. Success is a very sweet revenge when it comes to professional life. And in personal life, the only way where I could handle my mother's death, because I had just joined Radio Mirchi, which was my first identity in the city as an RJ. I landed up becoming a radio jockey. I was in the training session. My mother had ironed a sari. It was 12 years back. She had ironed the sari for the first time. I was going to office wearing a sari, you know. And I was so happy. I was excited. I had joined radio and I never knew what was happening. But all I knew was that the same sari I was wearing the very next day while I was putting fire on her face. So for me, going back to that radio station room again, where I heard her voice for the last time, was coping up with myself on an everyday basis. Because when you hear a radio jockey, you don't see the person. So you don't know whether I'm speaking to you with tears in my eyes or I have been battered by my husband the last night, because I have to, as a professional, sound to you, always khush, mirchi sunne wale always khush. For 6 years I've done that. The 6 years where I've faced my mother's death in 10 hours time, where I've been through a broken marriage and I had a very bad experience for 3 years. For that, in those 6 professional years, my personal life every day could have come as a negative shadow, but my voice and my radio jockey profession did not give me a chance to sound anything but to sound happy at the end of the night and make you feel good about it. So work, and I had I had worked definitely beyond my designated work. So for me, the RJ was about radio journalism. I have done my professional life. I have a lot of dreams. But grief is something, it attacks you when you let it attack you. We just have to be stronger than anything, any obstacle, because God doesn't say no, He says later or something better.
So you said that the choice, should we move on or not? Am I right?
No, I didn't say. I said, is it the best way of overcoming the grief? And the sooner you are able to develop that feeling, that life has to go on,
yes,
the better it is.
Yes. See, the options are, don't do anything. Sometimes what happens, people become comatose. Okay? They are in coma, they are in shock for years. I have got a shop, there is a shop in Delhi. That lady is around 80. Okay? Her husband died maybe when she was 30 something. Okay? Now you ask her, do you have, auntie, aapke paas ye hai? You know what she says? Uncle nahi hai, uncle hote to ho jata. Okay? That is one choice, option you've got. One choice is to keep on grieving. Now you have to understand one thing. Other option is die. I mean, you can commit suicide. But it is not your or my choice. Unless God is willing, you can't even succeed in suicide. Then it will be even more traumatic. And the one thing you have to understand, you are not alone. A lot of people are looking at you and they derive pleasure or pain from you. The closest people, if they see you grieving, do you think they feel happy? It is not good to be strong. It is not good. Strong is not holding the thing. Strong is crying out openly. mourn openly. It doesn't matter, because crying is one of the most courageous thing that you can do. Okay? Acceptance. Once you reach the acceptance level, then moving on becomes, you just, I'll give you an example of Nirbhaya parents. Nirbhaya parents are still fighting for that, even though not much has happened, but they are doing that. Okay, if you do that type of thing, you're actually turning a sad occasion into a benefit for humankind. So that is another choice you have got. You have to move.
Aged couple, the husband is almost 75, 76, and the wife is 73, 74. So they got a child, a son, after 35 years of marriage, and they did lot of, you know, yahan pe jao, wahan pe jao. They were not, she was not conceiving. So, and after 35 years of marriage, they got this son, one son only. So they, he was their only son. And then he grew up in the village itself, and he wanted to join the Indian Army. So the mother, because he insisted, so the mother said, okay, fine, you know, he wants to go. So he went into Indian Army, became, and 5 years back in the insurgency movement in Kashmir, he died. You know, so he... So imagine the only child went into the army and died, and there's, now there's nobody for them, you know. So one grandson they have, but then the daughter-in-law's family, they don't want to keep any relation, so they hardly see the grandchild also. So all these years also they hardly saw the grandchild. The grandchild is now 12 years old. So they absolutely have nobody. But over these 5 years, how I have seen them coping with this grief is, the woman, the lady, she went into total spiritualism and going and working with old age people homes and destitute homes. So she devotes her entire time now in doing seva in the old age people homes and doing got into spiritualism. Whereas he, the husband, he has dedicated himself in developing an academy for students. After 12th, he wants to build a military academy in that district and train those students, army as an option, as a career option. So he has put all his energies into acquiring land, going to the government, making the project proposal, and he also wrote a book. He spent his last 3 years in writing a book of, in Marathi it is, how bringing up an army officer. So his experiences as a father in bringing up an army officer. So he wrote a book on the life of his son and his how what parents did. So I'm seeing how both of them, they dealt with this grief in their life. You know. So today they have nobody, absolutely. They are all alone. They are aging. But they are all the time also working in the fields because they have an agriculture land. So they work in the fields. They grow their own fruits, vegetables, they are doing seva, they are, you know, so amazing how they are coping up, you know, and getting on, and the enthusiasm. Like he came that day to Bombay because he had to go to Nagpur, and when I was going to drop him to the railway station, you know, he said, you know, December is the time, he's 76 year old, okay. So he's telling me, December is the time when, because it's an Alfonso region where their village is. So now the flowering happens on the trees. So you're saying, Bombay, see the Bombay traffic, you can only smell the pollution. But you come to our village, you can you know, smell the fragrances of the flowering. And so nice, and then the morning sun, and his eyes had lit up and he was so happy. And I was thinking, my God, imagine to have that enthusiasm. To retain that enthusiasm, having gone through the grief of the only child's death, and also nobody, they can't go meet the grandchild also. Sometimes maybe they, if the daughter-in-law says okay, they go all the way to Dehradun, because Shimla, because he's in the army school there, so they go there and meet him, you know. So I find that very inspirational, you know, the way they have coped up and then they are facing. Absolutely. And getting on with their life.
Right, I think, you know, that we have had the one weapon, the one mantra that we all have held on to handle grief. I think today in this forum, if we can have an exchange of the weapon as women, as people, as a race, we will just emerge a bit stronger. So over to Jonakidi, I would like to ask you first.
In my personal life,
When I felt grief when I lost my father, and it was, I think till date, it is the biggest grief I felt, the one thing which helped me was immediately get back to work. And while teaching, I used to cry and teach, but I immediately went back to work, and I think that greatly helped me. And the second thing which helped me was to seek out. Because if you feel my father, I have now found many father figures. It is only if you seek out. Like we usually restrict ourselves and we feel my mother, my child, my daughter, my son. And if we just embrace the world, like my both my children are abroad and I miss them terribly. And that is also like my way of feeling grief. Not grief that way, because they are doing very well in life, but I miss them so much. But I have embraced, I feel all my students are my children. So it is just the way you feel. If you feel each one of you present in the room are my family members, then I will not miss my father. I will find my father figure, my brother figure, my friend, my sister in all of you. And believe me, the world has got so much of love. You just have to ask for it. And everyone feels so much for you. You'd be so surprised that the way they will come and they will embrace you, they will give you love. We just don't reach out. That's the thing. Because of our inhibition, because we are shy, because we feel what will happen if I reach out, what will happen if we say we are upset, if I cry in front of them. But you'd be so surprised that from people you've never imagined, they will come to you and they will give you so much of love and affection. So we just restrict ourselves. Who said that the world is our family? It is the way we see. It is the way we perceive. If we feel that everyone is my family, then who says I've lost one member? Each one of us are, you know, we are together.
All right. I will add on to her. There was a video which went viral on YouTube. It was about a 13 years old girl whose father was in Gorkha regiment.
Yeah.
Can you share that? What was that video?
Yeah, I think she was there when the prayers were lit.
Yes.
And she saluted, and she said that, you know, I would like to dedicate all my life to be a part of.
No, not did. That. The video actually make the girl
salute. Yeah.
And she was the Gorkha regiment has a cry, war cry. She said that.
Sorry.
The Gorkha regiment has got a war cry. They want their own. Okay.
They have a tune, and you know they raise your elbows and
join one party or something like that.
Yeah, whatever.
Sat Sri Akal,
if you.
Sat Sri Akal is for the Akali regiment.
Okay, so what?
All the regiments have a war cry, which they say when they.
And the most important part. And sometimes, if it is a reason because somebody has died who was very close to you, then create something on your memory. There has been a lot of things. Lot of big thing has been created in the world. One of the lady I met, who I told yesterday, Arunima Sinha. Almost all my idols are females, okay? And they have gone through trauma and they have come back big. Arunima Sinha lost one leg completely and other leg was half, okay? Still she climbed Mount Everest, okay? Because Bachendri, another person I know, she had done that, right? Trauma can bring you total loss for you and your family. It can totally finish your family. Or if you use the purpose, find the purpose, then trauma or grief can create a miracle for you and for all the world. Now, you want to ask?
Yes, I think before we wrap up, I'm really curious to know you and your weapon, because it's just going to help me and us. Please.
But when I actually went through a great personal loss, I remember very clearly the duality in my mind, where I knew that I had two choices, that I can give in and let myself go totally and immerse in the grief and just be there, or I can get out of it. It was like, you know, I'm standing at the edge of a cliff, I can either jump or go back. It was as clear. So it is always a choice that we make somewhere.
Yes.
That it is very easy to give in, you know, because you don't have to do anything and it's you're just wallowing and nothing is happening. But to come back from that cliff and make, you know, get out of it and then find a purpose, because the purpose is there, definitely is there. So it is always a choice that we make, and I think my faith helped me a lot there.
Perfect. So choice and then
jealousy, his elder brother pushed him in a ditch and he was an accident. With that accident he lost his voice. This is a 17-year-old guy. Okay, the father finally gave him love to music. Every time he would sing and he would cry. That again, I mean, one alternative was this. Okay, fine, you can't work, you can't go in for further education, open up a shop, but that is something not that he liked. As it is, he was used to cry. Every time he would listen to some good music, he landed up again in the mental hospital. So I think alternatives, one has to move on, I agree, but then alternative, I don't know, I mean, like for this particular case, how do we comment on his recurring effect?
Sometimes this is uncontrollable. Sometimes it is because, sometimes it is just destined. These three things are there. So, okay. But if you did not get help, you tried everything, if it doesn't have, then it's a different issue. But if you have not tried, and just sitting and waiting for something to happen, because people think time will kill the grief. No, it doesn't happen. Some people will grieve even after years. So the way to is, like she said, before every important date which reminds you of that person, prepare how you're going to handle. Like what we have done now, every time a father's death anniversary or birthday comes, we decided we'll go cook ourselves and feed people who are underprivileged. So that is our way. So it is your way. Okay, prepare one thing. Second, don't grieve alone. Please don't grieve alone. Grieve openly. Okay? It doesn't matter. People think crying openly. I, as a male, let me tell you, I cried in one of the workshops. Okay? Somebody was telling, what kind of workshop you are doing? But you won't believe, it was with 200 teachers of a school called Global Indian International School in Singapore. Okay? I did not get a better feedback without that. So crying openly is a sign of courage. Grieve openly. Seek help. Always find a purpose. This is the only way. Get to the routine.
Just small changes, I think, will take care of everything. Just to wrap up the last two lines, that I want to thank my the people on my right and my left who are absolutely right on everything they have left behind with us. Thank you so much. Grief as a word, as small as it is, with one change of alphabet, it will just be brief. So just change the G to B. Be brave to face it. Be confident about yourself. And as 2017 brings in such a warm and wonderful forum, with Women Economic Forum being a part of our lives at the beginning of the year, I'm sure all the griefs will be erased. We'll have a lighter, brighter year and a great life ahead. Thank you so very much from all of us.
And I would like to thank all of you for bearing with us. I know this grief is